Bangalore, Trivandrum, and our online friends. We can start. We can start with the history questions. First, I will do the history part in the mains question paper of test 11. Rest of the things will be done by Ms. Rajita and then by Mr. Gautam. Ms. Rajita will do the sociological part and Mr. Gautam will do the geographical part. Ms. Rajita and Gautam is going to be connected from Bangalore. Okay, they are out of station. They are there in the class. They will connect from Bangalore to here in Chennai. Okay, so we go for the history questions. First question. Examine how the Mughal paintings reflect the life of royals while the Rajput paintings reflect the life of the people. So it's a 10 mark question. So the introduction. Okay, so in the introduction, we have to write about the paintings of the Mughals. So the Mughal painting. So the Mughal painting, we have to start it when it was started. So it was started with the time actual painting was started during the period of Akbar. Okay, so with that period of Akbar, the Mughal painting was started. The Mughal painting where, because it's a 10 mark question, we need to give a very small introduction. It is enough here. So it is a blend of the or fusion of the Persian and the indigenous. Persian and the indigenous paintings in India during the medieval period. So that's need of the introduction. And it is the Mughal where the royal. The Mughal were the royal. And yes, the Mughal paintings were royal in character because the Mughal paintings were aristocratic in nature. Aristocratic? It was aristocratic in nature because most of the paintings were reflect and the scenes of the court of the Mughals. The court of the Mughals. Are the court proceedings of the Mughals. And then most of the Mughal paintings are reflecting the materialistic life. The materialistic. Materialistic. Materialistic in plunder and pompous. Plunder and pompous. Okay. And most of the paintings of the Mughals were reflecting the materialistic of the Mughal royal life, like hunting, and that lifestyle. So they were exhibiting the royalness. And most of the Mughal paintings were considered to be as a, that was the less folk art or alienation of the folk art. There was no any progress of the civilization of the common people. So that's why, because of these things, the Mughal paintings were considered to be as royal in character. And the Rajput paintings were people's character because it was the life of the people. Rajput. The Rajput. They were the life of the people. Life of people. Here in the life of the people, the daily activities of the people, the common life of the people of the Rajput states were reflected there in the Rajput paintings, life of the people. And it was not materialistic. The Rajput paintings were the spiritualistic in character because spiritual. Spiritual. Because most of the paintings during the most of the paintings of the Rajputs are explaining or exhibiting the religious tendencies. For example, Radha Krishna, that is a Radha Krishna painting, or the Krishna cult, or Radha Krishna cult. So it was spiritual in character. And the Rajput paintings were fusion of the folk art. Fusion of the folk art. Folk art. And the Rajput paintings were democratic in sense. Democratic in sense. And the question is about examine. Either if you examine here, it is fine, or if you examine at the end, it is fine. If you do here the examine for the Mughal painting, then it is fine. Or if you examine separately for the Rajput at the end, it is fine. Or if you do the examine collectively at the end before conclusion, it is also fine. The Mughal paintings where it is not wonder. There is nothing to wonder here in the case of the Mughal paintings of royalness, because it was in the initial stage. It only confined the court. So all the paintings were confined to the courtroom and it exhibit the royalness. But it possesses the secular tendency. But in the case of the Rajput paintings, it reflect the life of the people, but it was having a religious tendency because the Rajput states were under the Bhakti cult. So the Bhakti was there. That's why Radha Krishna cult. That's why most of the thing. So it was because of this thing. So in the examine, Mughal were court, initial stage. The Rajput were the Bhaktis, or you can take the stand. It was because of the decentralization. Another examine also you can take. It was the centralized government. So the painting was also centralized within confined to the imperial court. In the later part, when the Rajputs have came back to their home state, when the later period after the 17th and the 18th century, when the Rajputs regional states were emerged, it was a time for the Rajput states to have a decentralization. That is a painting. So that was here in the Rajput states, that it was because of the decentralization. So examine. And at the conclusion, that it was at the conclusion. The Rajput painting, you have to give painting, you have to give conclusion for the royal and the Rajput paintings are generally about the painting. Anyway, the painting was started during the period of the Mughal period, but the modern painting was emerged because of the Mughal paintings and came down to the path of the 18th century, where it blundered with the Europeans and it was in the path of the modern painting. Conclusion. So modern painting. Modern painting. Not necessary to confine this one. Even you can confine here to the generally about the painting in the medieval era. So you can confine. The conclusion is our part. That is to the substantiating to our question. That's all. If you want to, within the boundary of the question, safe conclusion. So introduction for the painting, royal substantiation. Or you can examine at the end of royal paintings of the Mughal, Rajput painting, substantiation for that, and the examine part of the Rajput painting, and the conclusion of the painting. It is a 10 mark. So we can substantiate like this. This is the thing. Okay. Can we go for the next one? Okay. Next question, both in action and reaction, the Christian missionaries became the heralds of modernization of India. Okay, critically analyze. This is the question. Okay, so the introduction is about the Christian missionaries of India, the role played by the Christian missionaries. You can take the words from the question itself. Yeah, the Christian missionaries were considered to be as a modern herald of the modernization of India. They were considered to be as a pioneer in making India into the modern path, whatever the thing. For our convenience, we can take points from the question itself, either introduction or for the conclusion. So they were the pioneers. They were the pioneers for the modernization of India, who brought India into the modern path. Introduction. India into the modern path. Modern path. Okay. Introduction. Now, Or you can add a few more words. If in case if they asked it in 15 marks question, you can add the who brought India into the modern path by means of the 1813 Act and then the 1833 Act. You can bring it in case of it is a 15 mark question. So it's a 10 mark question. You can limit yourself there with a 3-line introduction itself. Then okay. Then the question is about the critical analysis. Question is about the critical analysis. So, critical analysis. So, in the critical analysis, we can separate it into positive critical analysis and then the negative critical analysis. Okay. What are the positive critical analysis of the Christian missionaries? Yes, they were the modernists and they were the people who brought India into the pioneer path. The main positive critical analysis of the Christian missionaries, they were the persons who were responsible for bringing the social reforms. Social reforms in broad spectrum. Social reform. They were the people who were crusade for women's. You can bring it. They were against sati. They were the people against for the dowry system. They were the people against the purdah system. And they have waged a crusade war against the women's problem. And they were the people against the infanticide. Infanticide. That is the thing. And they were against the idolatry. Worship. Idolatry. And positive criticism. And they were the people responsible for criticizing the caste system. Caste system that it was existed in India in the name of the untouchability. They want to remove the, in the caste system you bring the untouchability here. Not the entire caste system they criticize. In the caste system they criticize more about the untouchability. Untouchability. And then they did a humanitarian works during the time of the disaster. For example, at the time of the famine, humanitarian works. And during the time of a drought, during the time of the famine, during the time of a plague, all these did the humanitarian works, positive criticism. And if you come for the critical analysis, so it is a negative critical analysis we need to give. And all these done by the Christian missionaries with the motive of the conversion. Conversion. That is converting to the Christianity. And because of this conversion, it evoked a reaction. Evoked a reaction. Reaction from the Orthodox Hinduism. Orthodox Hinduism and leaders. Hinduism and the leaders. For example, you can bring it here, the Lala Lajpat Roy. You can bring it here, that is the Tilak. Bal Gangadhar Tilak. And all these things you can cite as an example. That is a value addition part here. If you give few of examples here, that is a value addition part here. And then, apart from this, there is nothing there. And they attacked the entire thing. That is, apart from this, there is nothing. They have did all this thing. Few of the critical analysis of them. And then, for the conclusion part. The conclusion part. What is the conclusion you have to give for this? Anyhow, even though the question is about modernization of India, so the more conclusion we can give, even though they did this thing, conversion and all these things, the entire social reform in India was because of the Christianities, Christian work. So, here in the conclusion, whatever the criticism may be, and the social reform in India was because of the social reform. In India was because of the reaction of the Christian missionaries. So, they were the people who brought India into the modern path. Modern path. So, can bring it. Bring it like this. Both positive critical analysis, the negative critical analysis, and the conclusion. If you give any other conclusion than this, you can bring this part into the conclusion. You can bring this here in the conclusion. That is, they were the pioneers in bringing India into the modern path. And they were the India, they were the heralds of the heralds of India in the path of modernization. You can bring it here. Use the question here, words here in the conclusion also, in case if you not used it in introduction. So these are the points: positive and negative, critical analysis, and then the conclusion for that. Okay. Next one. The League of Nations failed not because of the League, but because of the notions of the League Nations. Analyze. Okay. So introduction. So the introduction. The introduction about the League. The introduction about the League. The League of Nations was started after the World War I. It was started in the Paris Peace Conference as to maintain the global collective security. Global collective security. Okay. The League of Nations. And then it was not because of the League. Not of the League. It was not failed because of the League, because the League was an organization. There was no it was not failed because of as an organization. Because of as an organization. Because you have substantiated to that. Because it was failed because of the notions of the League of Nations. League of Nations. Now you have to write for this. League was not failed as because of the League. It was because of the notions of the League. Notions means different perspective of different nations. That's why it was failed. Notions of the nations. And here it is an analysis question. So you have to take the analysis for each and every point. Absenteeism of the member countries. Absenteeism. Here you have to take analysis for that. It was absenteeism because the most powerful nations were absented in the League. For example, to say United States of America was not a member there because the US Senate never approved for the membership of the League of Nations. So because of it, it was a failed one because of the different stand. Because of that, use the word in the question. Because of the notions of the United States of America stand. And the different facility for the member states. And when Japan and Italy were invaded into Abyssinia and then in the Manchuria, when League criticized because of the stand, they withdraw the membership. So withdrawal. Withdrawal, absenteeism, analysis the part. And the second part, national interest. Okay. Every country in the League of Nations tried to protect their only national interest, not for the global interest, not for the global perspective or not for the global collective security. For example, to say, France was more concerned for crippling Germany and the encircling Germany. France never worked for the collective security of the European continent. So it was failed there. League was not failed here because of the stand that was taken by France to encircle Germany, not to give a collective security for the European continent. So here, France, you can take it as an example here in the analysis. You have to bring the country for analysis point here as an analysis. And here, economic sanctions. The economic sanction. The economic sanction was an armed power rest with the League, but when it comes to the execution part, in 1920s, for example, to over Italy and Japan, the stand that was taken by Britain and France over the economic sanctions were different. Because of that, the economic sanction provision itself became powerless in the league. Because here you have to bring the incident of the Japan and Italy. And here, balance of power. Here, the balance of power should be maintained for the global peace, but instead of the global peace, the Britain and France, who ran the league between the wars, took their own balance of power. So they have took the balance of power according to their own convenience. So British and France analysis here. British and France, balance of power. Equality of states. The equality of the member countries. And you have to bring it here, the different notions. Of course, to maintain the equality in the league, every country had one vote, every country had an equal stand. But when there comes a crisis situation, certain powerful countries must need an extra inequality to prevent the crisis. Here you bring it here. United Nations organization, where the powerful five countries enjoying the crimi veto power. So here the UN and the veto, you bring it here. So that is why preventing the crisis situation, most of the thing. So the league, I write the conclusion here. Conclusion. So it's a 10 mark, we can confine it to this few of the points. So the league was actually not failed. The league was strengthened and it was a powerful one. It was not the league, organizationally it was not a failed one, because of the different perspective of the notions of the nation, leagues of the nation, league of the nations, it was a failed one. So here, notions of the nations. So that is analysis. So what analysis here? Simple analysis. You can bring it any positive or negative. It is an extra value addition part. You can get extra marks there. In case if you critically analysis, even though it is not asked, in case if you do some of the critically one or two points here, it's a value addition part. No problem. If you bring the analysis, that is fine, good. Third question, the League of Nations failed. Okay, that is about the thing. So, introduction, not the league, notions of the nations with analysis part. Okay. Go for the next one. What were the causes for widespread peasant movements after independence? This is one part. Enumerate some of the peasant movements after 20th century. So there are two parts in this question. Okay. So the introduction part. So it is about the peasant movements of the 20th century were the more violent and struggle against the state. Simple enough here. And now what you needed to do here was, immediately after independence, many peasant agitations, many peasant movements came up because of the problems that were not solved by the British. They left as it was. So you needed to have a connecting point between that to the post-independence. So here you needed to give a small connecting point here. The British left India without solving any of the land reforms are the land problems what were came up during the period, and that was continued after the independence. That continue word you need to be given here. British problems, land problems, problems continued after independence. After independence, if you do this connection, it is extra mark, extra value addition here. Otherwise, if you skip this area and jump into the problem, the answer body is hanging. That would be hanging. No connectivity there. There is one connection there. Many certain questions is like this. You need to connect the earlier part and the present part through a small connection. In history, many areas is like that, where we need to connect. One area is land reforms area, because land reforms is not genuinely after independence. It was because of the British. So in that area, you need to have a small connection between the British and then to the post-independence, like this. Okay, come further. This is the thing. Causes. That is the first part. What were the causes? The causes. So it is a 10 mark question. If you list out the causes, it is enough. If you take few causes and explain it in two lines, then it is also fine and good. That is extra mark. So that was the land reforms failure in the post-independence. Because of that, redistribution of land problem. The land redistribution of land. So here we are speaking only about the land. Agrarian crisis, so it is connecting to the land. So I am not going to write anything land. So redistribution of the land. And that was the eviction problem. Eviction. In most of the areas, the peasants were evicted by the landlord. That created a lot of agitation in the post-independence period. The issues of the sharecroppers. The sharecroppers were denied of the sharing the crop. That was considered to be as a livelihood. So they were agitated. And that was the non-revenue extractions. Non-revenue extraction means in many of the areas no revenue, but the farmers are forced to do some of the work for the landlords. That is non-revenue extraction, working in the farm and doing some middling activity like this one. This created a lot of distress among the peasants. They were forced. And apart from this, connecting to that, when they were forced to do that work, that was called forced labor. Rural indebtedness. Rural indebtedness. Like this, if you list out few of the thing, okay, or if you explain two lines of these things, then it addresses the first part of the question. Then we come for the second part and enumerate some of the major peasant movements. So we are asking you to enumerate only. So explain or that if you do in two lines, then it is okay. Peasant movements. That is enumeration. Enumeration means simply we are going to list out there or explaining in two lines. That was the thing. Peasant movement that came up after independence, that it was in the case of Tibanga. Even though it was started before independence, but it continued, the problem continued after independence also. It was related to the land distribution. If you explain, then it is okay. And then Telangana peasant movement. The Telangana peasant movement. the Telangana peasant movement, when there was a famine happened, the food became the crisis for the people of the Telangana area. So the landlords were hoarded the crops and the grains, and there was a blocking the entire grains during that in that area. So it made the peasants to agitate, and they were forced to grab all the grains from that area, and police were cracked down, and they were heavily forced over them, and then the Telangana peasant movement came to an end. And then that was in the 1976. It was in the case of the Bihar peasant movement, or we can call it as a Bodh Gaya movement. Bodh Gaya movement, where in the Bodh Gaya, the large acres of the land were brought under the control of one under the Bodh Gaya shrine, and the landless people were asking for the land, and because of that, the landless people were forced to enter into the land of the Bodh Gaya, and the Bodh Gaya committee went into the Supreme Court. At last, the Supreme Court asked them to separate the land for the landless people. That was the Bodh Gaya movement or the Bihar peasant movement. Srikakulam, Andhra, the Srikakulam movement. The Srikakulam peasant movement. That was for the redistribution of the land. That was in the case of the redistribution of the land. And after that, Naxalbari, we know that. Naxalbari, it is also where the big zamindars have large tract of land. The landless people were asked them to give the land for the landless people. That leads to the agitation of the peasants between the zamindars and the peasants, which led into the movement that was called the Naxalbari movement. That was a con. And Pabna. Sorry. Patiala. The Patiala peasant movement against illegal extraction of rent. In Punjab. So, if we explain these in few lines, then it is okay. And normal conclusion. I write conclusion here. The conclusion part. The government failed in some conclusion part. In some areas, the government has successfully come across for the problem of the land revenue problem for passing up of the zamindari abolition like this in few areas. Still, the land problem was still existing because of the no records that was present. There was the exact data and the exact record was not present, and still it is considered to be as a problem for the India after independence. So you can bring the conclusion in real situation. Some areas problem solved, some areas still it is present because of the land reform failed. So land reform is a failed one. So bring it the conclusion here. If you want to bring it into a positive tone of the conclusion, positive conclusion, you can bring it problem, still problem is present here and there. That's all. Okay. The fourth question. Okay, 11th one. 11th one. What is Rowlatt Act? Do you think Rowlatt Satyagraha was a palpable failure? Describe how it led to the non-cooperation movement. So, there are three parts in the question. The first part, definitely you have to write what is mean by Rowlatt Act. It is a 15 mark question. So, that should be the introduction part of you. Introduction. In the introduction part, you have to write it. What is Rowlatt Act? The Rowlatt Act is nothing but it is called the Anarchical Revolutionary Criminal Crime, Anarchical Revolutionary Criminal Act of 1919. That you have to explain here. And it was brought by the British judge Sidney Rowlatt. If you write this one, it is well, otherwise no problem. And you have to bring in the provisions of the Rowlatt Act. And anyone can be arrested without any trial. and it can be arrested without any warrant, and they can confined without any trial. The case is to be present only before three high court judges without any jury. Like that three provisions, if you give it in the introduction for this one paragraph, it is enough, because that collectively says what is Rowlatt Act. The Rowlatt Act and the personality who created it, and that is the provisions of the Rowlatt Act, and it is also called as, you write it, Black Act. It is also called as Black Act. Okay, this is the first part. Second part, do you think Rowlatt Satyagraha was a palpable failure? So we are moving for the second part, palpable failure. So palpable failure, to some extent we can say that it is a palpable failure, because the main objective of the Rowlatt Satyagraha was to repeal the Rowlatt Act. Not happened. So in the first act it was not repealed. Here you can say it, that is to some extent we are enumerating the point. To some extent it was considered to be as a failed, because the core objective of the Rowlatt Satyagraha was to repeal the act, but it was not happened, so it was considered to be as a palpable failure. The main objective of the Satyagraha was to engage in the Satyagrahi activity in the form of a non-violence. But in many areas when the Rowlatt Satyagraha was practiced, and in many areas there was sporadic violence, and it was a palpable failure, and the mass have not learned about the Satyagraha. The mass have not learned about the concept of the Satyagraha. Not learned about Satyagraha. Concept here you write it. The concept, not the concept. The mass have not learned about the concept of the Satyagraha. That's why they don't know what is about the non-violence and ahimsa and the Satyagraha. That's why it was considered to be as a failed. Because mass have not learned about the, was not educated about the Satyagraha, Rowlatt. So that's why it was a palpable failure to some extent. But coming for the next one, considered to be as a palpable failure, but in the same question, palpable failure, we are coming across. But we cannot say it as a failure, because it was the first time the Indian mass come across the non-violence activity. Non-violence activity. And the Rowlatt Satyagraha gave a national leader for the entire forthcoming mass movement. That was Gandhi as a leader. The mistake that was learned by the mass, that was recorrected and going to be used in the subsequent movement, in the case of the non-cooperation movement. So it teach the mass about the mass activity or mass movement. So we cannot totally say it as a palpable failure. To only some extent it was failure, but if you take the entire national movement into a broad spectrum, it is in the infant stage. So all mistakes were corrected in the subsequent movement. So you give a pre-conclusion for this palpable failure itself. Certain questions we needed to give a pre-conclusion. This question is one such questions where we have to give a pre-conclusion. And then come for the next one. Describe how it lead to non-cooperation movement. So that is the third part of your question. So lead to, what is the keyword here? Lead to. Led to non-cooperation movement, NCM. After the Black Act was passed, now we are coming from the introduction. After the passing up of the Black Act, Gandhi gave an ultimatum. Gandhi gave an ultimatum to the government to repeal the act to the Viceroy. But the Viceroy never repealed the act, and the government ended the ultimatum, and Gandhi launched the Rowlatt Satyagraha in the name of the National Hartal. National Hartal. By the time of the National Hartal was there in Punjab, the government have arrested two of the Congress leaders, that is Saifuddin Lu and then Satyapal, Dr. Satyapal. So, because of this protest there, arresting the Congress leaders and other problems present there, it leads to the Jallianwalabagh massacre. Added to the Jallianwalabagh massacre, because of the international effect or impact, where the caliphate was abolished, because of the abolition of the caliphate, Gandhi cooperated with the Muslims, Islam here, and he launched the Khilafat movement. With the continuation of the Khilafat movement in 1920, it ended with the non-cooperation movement. So that ended with the non-cooperation movement. So that is to be connected here. So describe how you lead to the non-cooperation movement. That is the thing. If you end here, then if you don't need to say, then it is okay. But you need to hear, because why? This is the most important area, because 1919, 1918, 1919, we are in the 2019, this area, non-cooperation movement, Jallianwalabagh, League of Nations, Treaty of Versailles, all these are in 1919. You please have a sight over that. And that is a potential area of asking question from this year, that is in the prioritized area. Anyway, from the First World War or post First World War era, questions definitely may be there, prioritized area. Okay. So, this is about the then conclusion. Then conclusion. So, it is a three-part question. It is a three-part question. So, it is entirely about the Rowlatt Satyagraha and connecting to the Rowlatt Satyagraha only. So, this is an added part here. So, you can give conclusion for the Rowlatt Satyagraha here. You can bring the pre-conclusion. So introduction, what introduction need to be right for this? Introduction. The personalities were differed over their ideas. The personalities were differed over their ideas. For example, to say in the national movement, the different ideologies and different strategies were followed by different personalities. For example, to say that it was with a clash between the Gandhi and the Subhash Chandra Bose and the Gandhi and the Ambedkar, and less one was to found that most vivid one was between the Gandhi and then the Nehru. When if you give it in the broad spectrum or generally to the confining to the question, it was a clash of personalities or the ideas in the strategy and in the program between the Gandhi and Nehru, where had difference of opinion in implementing the strategies and in the programs in the 1930s. Okay, here they are simply asking the difference between the two. That is, okay, the difference here, both of them. Okay, first we have Nehru here on this side, and on the other side we can have Gandhi. So how these two were differed in their programs and then the strategy. First and the foremost one, everyone knows that it is very common there in the entire book. Nehru was completely opposing to the idea of Gandhi, where the Gandhian strategy of the national movement was struggle to struggle, that is struggling and taking a brief constructive program and then to getting some concession from the government by means of the constitutional agitation and then by means of the struggling after that. So the entire strategy of the Gandhian movement was struggle to struggle. But Nehru was completely opposed for this struggle in the 1930s. He thought that struggling and then taking a breath and recuperating for another struggle can completely liquidate the movement. So there is nothing use in the struggle to struggle. We have to directly have the strategy to struggle. We need to directly strike the imperialist government. So we have to follow the struggle to victory. Yes, we. That is the first and the foremost one. Ideologically, both of them were different. Struggle to struggle and struggle to victory. Next one. Nehru in the 1930s was mostly with the idea of the Marxism and socialistic thought. But Gandhi was completely differed with this ideology of Marxism and socialism, and he never considered that as an, he was very silent in him. He was very silent. And he was not sanctioned about this ideology in any of the platform. He was very silent or non-approve or differ over this ideology, Gandhi. Next one, here in this, Nehru, till the time of the 1930s, the entire Congress movement were not based only on the class basis, not on the entire mass movement. Even non-cooperation movement, civil disobedience movement was over by this time. Majority of the peasants, majority of the workers, majority of the laborers were alienated of the mass movement in 1930s. He wanted the class who needed to bring to the mass, Nehru. But Gandhi never considered about this one. He was differed with the anti-imperialistic struggle. So Gandhi have a different strategy regarding this class struggle. Next one, 1927, Nehru was the leader of the All India State People's Congress. He wanted to include the princely states into the movement, mass movement, include into the Congress platform. That is inclusion of the princely states. The princely states. But Gandhi never accepted this idea till the end. He never accepted the idea of bringing the princely states into the Congress platform or to the agitation. That was deferred here. Deferred or not approved. And then Nehru was a different ideology after the suspension of the civil disobedience movement of the council entry program. He was in favor of the council entry program, but Gandhi was always against about the council entry program. Against. And Nehru criticized for suspending the civil disobedience movement. Gandhi was justifying for that. Justification for that. So both the Gandhi and Nehru were even though working on the same platform, both of them were differed in their ideologies, differed in their programs against anti-imperialistic struggle and strategies. In the 1930s, not only 1930s, after 1930s, and then the conclusion for that, even though both of them had differed in their opinion, strategy in the opposing the imperialistic British imperialism in all sense, but they were always compromising with their ideas for the interest of the Indians. That is for the interest of the people. Nowhere else. On one occasion, Gandhi told that Jawaharlal Nehru was considered to be as a successor after him. Even though there was a difference of opinion. While coming to the interest of India, they have buried the difference and they have be people's leaders. That was the thing. So conclusion, you ended with a positive tone because that is a reality also. even though difference of opinion. In case, whatever it may be Gandhi and Subhash Chandra Bose, both of them have the objective of India to get the freedom. Gandhi and Ambedkar differ in their opinion, but objective was the same. So, all these people have differed with Gandhi in different strategy, different ideologies, but all these people's objectives were on same stand. So, while you ending the question in the conclusion, always reflect with a positive tone about taking a positive stand regarding the objective of Indian National Movement, that is getting freedom for India. That is a correct one also. Okay. Discuss the impact of First World War on European colonies in Asia and Africa. Explain how the colonial questions were dealt with in the peace treaties. Okay. So the introduction part. In the introduction part, this is about the colonies after the First World War they are speaking about. So here in the introduction part, the First World War brought the colonization to an end in one way, not end, end in one way and in one way and brought the colonies to the limelight. The limelight or national movement there in the colonies. Anyway, colonies, national movement, limelight, one way there, colonization somewhat come to an end, like this if you give introduction, then it is okay. And then they are asking about impact after First World War in Asia and Africa. So impact, broad spectrum impact. If you write it one by one, one by one, one by one, that is also correct. Or if you write it West Asia, Asia, and then Southeast Asia and Africa, that is also fine. That would address you because it is a 15 mark. So if you segregate it like that, in that broad spectrum, if you write it, then it is okay. For example, the impact. In the impact, if you subdivided that into West Asia, that is as the West Asia. In the West Asia, what was the impact brought by the First World War over the colonies? And here, in the West Asia, it was the Ottoman Empire which was present. This Ottoman Empire was completely abolished. And after that, in the remains of the, from the territories of the Ottoman Empire, the British, the mandates were created. You have to bring that word mandate here. The mandate were created. This mandate were brought under the control of the British and then the French. For example, the present Palestinian brought under the British, Syria, Lebanon brought under the French mandate. So here they were brought under the mandate of the League, and those mandate were brought under the control of the British and the France. Ottoman, West Asia. Come for Asia. Here in the case of the Asia, you have to write about India also here. Asia, here in India, after the impact of the First World War, you have to write it about the Rowlatt Satyagraha and then the non-cooperation movement, simply political awakening in the form of the national movement, more aggressive form of the national movement, like the non-cooperation movement, 3-line, 4-line, it is enough here. And then, with the case of China, still we are under the division of Asia. In China, the spread of communism here, because of the spread of communism, there was a opposition from the nationalistic government which was run by Chiang Kai-shek. So there was a complete opposition between the Kuomintang government and the communist revolutionaries. So you can simply write it here. In China, because of the impact of the civil war where communism was spread, because of the communist revolutionaries under Mao Zedong opposing for the Chiang Kai-shek government, China underwent into the civil war. Civil war. Impact for independence, civil war, that is communist revolutionary fighting for the independence of China from the foreign influence, that is from the foreign powers who kept China under its control.
Okay.
China. Next, in the case of Korea. In the Korea, simply right. Korea was brought under the control by Japan. So the Koreans are fighting against the Japanese. So here, Japanese. Against Japanese. If you write, then it is Japanese. Philippines. So, Indochina. Indochina. Against the Vietnamese, against French. In Burma, against British. Anyway, it comes under Southeast Asia, but in the NCERT book that they have segregated here only. Okay, that's why I'm going with the Burma here. So the Southeast Asia. So this is regarding the Asia broadly. Now we come for Africa. Africa. It's about Africa. In the Africa, emergence of national movement. Impact. National movement. Emergence of the national movement for the against the imperialist countries by the respective colonies in African countries. And then Pan-African Congress. Pan-African Congress here. For a political platform for the African countries to fight against the imperialism, they founded the Pan-African Congress. The Pan-African Congress. And then to collectively bring under the entire Africa under a cultural movement, they have started the Negritude movement. A cultural movement for the Africa. Cultural movement for the Africa entirely. Not necessary to bring South Africa here, West Africa here, North Africa here. Entirely you bring Africa here, because if they ask 15 marks about Africa, then you bring West Africa, North Africa, South Africa into a broad spectrum. So that is about the first part of the question. Explain how the colonial questions were dealt within the peace treaties. So we are moving for the next part of the question, third part. So colonies under peace treaties. So the colonies here, once again you have to bring out the same concept here. The colonies under the peace conference are put under the mandate. The mandate system, where the advanced nations to administer the colonies. Advanced nation to administer the colonies. Here, the defeated countries' colonies were shared. Sorry, not shared. Defeated countries' colonies were brought under the mandate of the respective league nation countries. For example, the Lebanon, Syria under France, the Palestinian under the British. The German colonies in Pacific was brought under control of Japan. The German colonies in Africa was brought under the mandate of the British. Like this, they put under the mandate system. End. You can write it for the mandate system. Entirely colonies only the question. Colonies were brought under the mandate system of League of Nations, but not collectively. Only few were brought under the control. So you can criticize the mandate system here in the end of the conclusion. So it is a conclusion part. Conclusion. So in the conclusion, the mandate system is responsible for the Second World War because it never ended the colonization. And the colonization was continued in another form because the League of Nations, which ran the mandate system, was run by British and France. So the British and France only redistributed the colony among themselves after the war. So this mandate system is responsible for the another war, Second World War. So the colonization was not ended after the First World War. But positive note, write it in the ending in a positive note, positive tone. Even though the colonization was not ended, but when comparing to the 19th century, the colonies have got more awareness. Ended with more awareness in the form of a national awakening in the path of independence. in the path of independence, you end with a positive tone. Try to end answers with a positive tone. Okay. So, peace treaties, the third part and the conclusion. Okay. Anything? Any doubt here? Any doubt there in that, yeah? Any doubt with Adyar people? Yes? No doubt? Thank you. Thank you. Adyar, Bangalore? Bangalore people? Any doubt? No? Kiran? Okay. Okay, Kiran. Thank you. Trivandrum people? Any doubt with the Trivandrum people? No? If you don't have any doubt, please raise. Raise your hand. Okay, thank you. Any online people having any doubt? Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
I know that you are hearing me. All right, thank you. So we'll start with the sixth question. What is herd mentality and how does it impact Indian culture and society? So 10 mark question, two parts. First is something like a definitional part. Maybe you could have one or two sentences about it. And then you could straight away go on to the impact part. Coming to the first part, herd mentality, so which means the mentality of an individual to follow the rest of the members of the group or to imitate the lifestyle or imitate the ways and mannerisms of another set of people and going with a crowd. That is what. So we can also call it as crowd mentality or mob mentality. And the reason why this has come into the picture is because of the increasing number of instances of mob violence that we are witnessing in the country. And they have a tendency to pick up a technical question from there. So you could have your own definitions and give some alternate words for the same. Coming to the second part, how does it impact the Indian culture and the society? There are multiple ways to structure this particular question. Either you could go with, say, the socio, cultural, political, economic, like that part, or you could broad base it based on generally Indian culture and Indian people and their mentality. So because it's a general studies question, if you take it that way, you can write a lot more points. So either way of structuring, it is good. Or you could have a third structure wherein you take a point and you say positives and you say negatives, and then you start giving examples for that. Fine. So I would want to write this particular question in a style wherein everything is getting included. Try to take the dimensions from the socio-cultural part, political part, etc., and have an analysis which is like going to be positives and negatives and give illustrations. So in that way, I'll combine many things and I'll at least be able to have 8 to 10 points to write for a 10 mark question. So we could go with few things. First one is, say, beliefs of the people. Beliefs of the people similar to the beliefs of the other people in the crowd, which means like people can get swayed in any particular direction. For example, the spread of fake news. Next is values. Small things can become big. Big things can become small. And there could be changes in the values of the people. And so what we can see is mob violence. We could see protest culture coming up, anti-institutional culture coming up. All these things we could cite it as a crowd mentality or as a mob mentality. So this is showing an indicator of the changes in the values. Next, choices for education. We could see that there is a herd mentality towards that. At one point of time, we could see that the South Indian trend of shifting towards professional courses and the North Indian trend towards shifting towards arts and humanities courses. I take up a course because everybody takes up a particular course, not because I want to take up that course. So we could see this in patterns of education choices of people. Marital choices, marital patterns. So we could talk about how choosing a particular bride or a groom from within a caste or within a religion or within a language, caste consciousness, religious consciousness of the people. And the counter to that, what we could see is leading to honor killings or shame killings. This could be cited as an example. You could also cite another example of how community-based matrimonial sites have become very famous because everybody follows it. So at one point, people were just going to a Jyotishi and going and finding out the matching. Today, all these things have come online. So there is a mentality towards shifting towards that. Then the trends in nuclear family. So once we could see that a family is having two children, we could see many families having that kind of a culture. Coming to a one child, many families coming to that kind of a culture. Getting whatever the children need and ensuring that kind of choices of the children are paid heed to, that could be seen in one part. So all this we could say in the socio-cultural part. Next is we could talk about voting patterns. There is a herd mentality in that. So now I can shift to politics. I could talk about voting patterns. And when voting patterns have a herd mentality, we could see multiple things. One, we could see a vote mobilization happening. We could also see a vote fragmentation happening. It could happen in any direction. Then in economics, I could think about consumerism. For example, brand craziness of people. Certain brands, they become very popular. Everybody wants to own a brand. You could extend it to technology as well. Certain kind of gadgets becoming very popular. Certain kind of cars becoming very popular. Owning luxury goods becoming very popular. So everybody needs to have it. If you don't have it, it's like as if there is no status for you in the society. So there's a herd mentality like that. Then you could discuss about food and mentality in that, like shifting towards a fast food culture. So if you don't know to talk about it, you will be left out. Sports and a herd mentality in that. So whether you are interested in a sport or not, when a group follows a particular sport, if you don't follow, you have nothing to talk to them. Talk to the rest of the people. So invariably, a person starts following a particular sport. So that could be another thing. Religion and religious discourses is another aspect that you could discuss. And this on one end could impact religious tourism. For example, you could talk about Attivaradar. You could discuss about, so there is this temple in Kanchipuram, which became very famous because the president visited that particular place. All of a sudden, there was like everybody visiting this particular place. We could see this in Amarnath. We could see this in Hajj pilgrimage. We could see this in various aspects. So you could talk about that as well. Okay? So we have at least from every dimension, we can pick a point and we could talk about how herd mentality has impacted this side as well as that side. You could balance it out and write. All right? So in such kind of questions, herd mentality, then it is irrational. Herd mentality with the rationality, with an individuality, it is a person's choice. But when there is no rationality in it, a person has to reconsider. Like that may be some kind of conclusion you could give with rationality. Okay? So now we'll go to the next question. Is it argued that far from being antithetical to democracy, caste has had an essential part to play in the advancement of democracy in India? Substantiate your view. This is very typical to the last year's question pattern, wherein they give us a sentence in quotation and then they ask us a view regarding that. So in such kind of questions, there is an expectation that the first paragraph of your answer should give some explanation to the statement that they have given, and then we go and present our view and have points to cite whichever view we are going to take. So let's first understand the question. Far from being antithetical, that means opposite to democracy, caste has played an essential part in advancement of democracy. So everybody thought that caste is going to pull democracy down. But we do see that some people are arguing that caste has in fact helped democracy go to a different level altogether. So that's the explanation. Now about our view. You can go with your view against the question. You can go with your view with the question. You can take a balanced view as well and you can say that certain instances we do see it is hindering democracy, certain instances it is emboldening democracy. You could go with three kinds of answers for this question. Whatever be your answer, I think you could have a basic set of points with which you can make your arguments. Your arguments or your view can be your own, but some points in this direction. So one aspect is social advancement of people with the concept of protective discrimination or reservation. Caste has played a role in that. Second is electoral constituencies getting delineated on the basis of caste. So equal political representation, you want to march towards equality as a dimension of democracy. So basic dimensions of democracy, you want to give equality, you want to pay heed to liberty, you want to talk about the spirit of brotherhood. These are the things that we want to cover in this answer. And we are telling that caste, positive or negative, you can write your answer based on these points. Okay, so one is reservation, second is electoral delineation, third is caste-based census. 1931 and later on in 2011, it has helped us to identify the vulnerable groups, and identification of a vulnerable group can help to do inclusion. So can help us to make targeted policies towards a particular group. So that can be there. Then we could see caste-based movements happening, some anti-caste movements happening in India, some caste consolidation movements happening in India. We could see various examples. So you could talk about the self-respect movement. You could discuss about the Mahar movement. You could also discuss about movements like the current Jat, Patel, Gujar movements as well. So you could take examples from different time points in history and you could make your point. Then caste correlating with class. So caste and class joining together in, say, the OBC creamy layer and, say, the EWS categorization which we have done. And so here we can find that caste is getting strengthened because it is joining with another institution or it is joining with class. Fine. Next, another dimension which we can say is caste is an accepted way of social life. To think about an Indian life without caste is very difficult because caste has not stayed within Hinduism. Caste has spilled over to every other Indian religion as well. So keeping these 4 to 5 basic points, you can base your argument that caste has pulled democracy down or caste has taken democracy forward. You could have your own arguments. Okay, a good way is I keep a point, pulled it down here, pushed it up here like this, and then you could have a view on it. Is it all right? Okay. And because it's a question dealing with democracy, with each point that you write, you correlate it with help to achieve equality. Caste-based movements, you can correlate it with liberty or the freedom or the expression of the people. Then you could discuss about the spirit of brotherhood wherein caste-based mobilization is happening, right? People coming together and making their choices in movements especially. That could also be cited. Okay? Kindly note, any system will have both pros and cons. So, caste system, it is a part of social life. You try to say about what are the positives and what are the negatives, right? And a good way to write this answer could also be like starting with a Gandhian and Ambedkarian approach and then coming to your argument, or ending with, say, a constitutional approach like that also. Your starting and ending part of the answer, you could tweak it and take your own view, all right? So in my opinion, I would end this kind of an answer by saying that caste as a system might have strengthened, but casteism or the caste-based evils are pulling Indian democracy down. This could be one of the ways in which you discuss. So here, untouchability, all that points and all, you can integrate and you can bring in. Some basic things, have it in your answer, right? Next, we could go to question number 18. The pattern of historical development has been different for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, with the latter never been an integral part of the mainstream society. And so they want to tell us that if the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, all throughout Indian history, they have been treated in a very different way. But today when I see, the scheduled tribes are very much behind scheduled caste and they are asking us to tell why. What are the reasons for it and how it is. So we could base our answer with initially an explanation for the historical development. A good way to write this answer is, you can start with the Varna system and then you can come on to the Simon Commission and discuss about how the Simon Commission initially spoke about the scheduled category, and post Simon Commission, you could come on to, say, discussion with the constitutional provisions, and later you could come up to Mandal. So I think 4 points you could have in your introductory paragraph wherein you tell the historical development of how this categorization of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes come in. Okay? And then you can go on to your basic points of the answer. So what are the points that you're going to keep in mind? So they have not asked your opinion. They have themselves stated that the STs are behind SC. So there is no point in writing it like a comment question. So some basic idea that you need to have is, again, you can go think in various ways. You talk about the social aspect, economic, political, like this you can think, and technological aspect. So in social aspect, you could talk about your educational opportunities available. Then you could talk about mainstream aspects like literacy and dimensions of literacy. Literacy being very low in the STs. You can talk about health and nutrition of the scheduled tribes being very much poor. You could talk about tribal poverty. Then you could talk about jobs done by the people helping to get more income when you compare SCs and STs. Then STs are remotely located, so joining them with policies has been a very difficult one in most of the time. Then you could bring in the dimension of technology, left behind by technology because not able to pick up or adjust with the changes in technology. You could talk about agriculture or cropping patterns and how it has helped the SCs when compared to the STs. Then you could also talk about the leaders available in the scheduled caste. They were pioneers, they were visionaries, they were able to bring up the scheduled caste much forward when compared to the scheduled tribes. Scheduled tribes empowerment happened in the only in the cases wherein Jharkhand movement had happened, and later on you can see creation of Chhattisgarh. But scheduled castes, on the other hand, right from the socio-religious reform movements itself, it has helped them to come to a better position. So with these basic points, you could tell. Then you can come to political side, political representation side. If you consider a non-reserved seat given to a particular person to contest in the election, we could see that only 1% of the seats are being availed or being given to the scheduled category people. And in the scheduled category people itself, if you compare how many SCs and how many STs are able to get the open seats given to the general people, we can see that SCs are only getting that 1% seat and ST person is hardly getting a seat. That means that much of elitism is there in the scheduled caste when compared to the scheduled tribes, even in a general electoral seat, a non-reserved electoral seat. So that is another... So more number of political representatives are comparatively there. So there is more of voice. And so we could see that there is a betterment opportunity as well. Fine. Then you can say to target this, there was this consideration of identifying the vulnerable groups. So we have identified the PTGs. Now we have identified the PVTGs. And you end your answer with to counter these things of backwardness. There is a current strategy. So end it with a current topic. So in health, nourishment and all, you should be talking MMR, IMR, all those things, communicable diseases, non-communicable. I've just given you the overall areas which all you should be covering. Each and everything points you have to take and you'll have to write it with examples as well. Okay? Next question. Religions are inherently patriarchal. Examine the influence of religion on patriarchy in India. So it's a very tricky question to write because it gets narrow. When they ask us the influence of religion on a society, it's easy to write. But when they ask us to combine two dimensions and then give an answer, it is a little tough to think and write the answer. But then once you start thinking, you can easily generate with a lot of examples. So the idea of taking this question was, previously they have asked a question, the impact of patriarchy on middle class working women in India. So they've gone to a very specific area of asking question. Recently, there is an expectation that they might get to specific questions in General Studies Paper 1. And so this question has been picked so that you are able to answer or handle specific questions. Okay. What is the context of asking this question here is, would have very recently, even yesterday in the paper, you would have read about how some nuns who had alleged that they were sexually assaulted, they were banished from the, they were asked to come out, right? So we could see that every religion is having some elements of patriarchy, and we are going to examine that, all right? So what are all the ways in which you are going to write this answer? Most of the religions, they are emphasizing patriarchy is one perspective. Some religions trying to change to counter patriarchy is another perspective. And judiciary and constitution trying to give equality is another perspective. So there are three basic areas of thinking to handle this particular 15 mark question. Otherwise, we will not get points to write a 15 mark question. Okay? So what should be the areas? Religion influencing personal laws. So religious personal laws would be one basic part wherein we can say religion is influencing patriarchy. So here there are going to be three basic areas. One is going to be inheritance, the property sharing. The second, inheritance, though it has become equal, we could still see that the patriarchal dimension is existing in the form of gifting or in the form of dowry. And religions are sanctioning that. Fine? Counter to this, you could say Islam, which is talking about an aspect called mahar or a bride price. So there we can see that there is a counter in dowry in the Islamic dower concept, D-O-W-E-R or bride price concept. But then is it being followed in a large way or not is the larger question to handle. Next is marriage, personal laws associated with marriage. Here again we can see across all religions, we could only recently see that the trend of adultery in divorce, the provision of adultery in divorce, this has become a little gender neutral. But initially we could see that who could put a case against who for adultery as a provision to take a divorce from a marriage, that was inherently patriarchal and constitutional intervention or judicial intervention or legal intervention and trying to overcome it. Religion, salvation, son preference. Okay? So you need a son to give you moksha, which is an inherent concept which is associated in a very vague way. No, in many cases it's an open way of why there are a large case of female feticide or where there is a very poor child sex ratio in India. So you could talk about salvation and religion. So religion, religious followers thinking behind salvation, and this is existing in almost all religions. Next, in marriage itself, marital rape and the discussions on marital rape, which is not going on in a further dimension at all, it shows the heavy influence of religion in this. Okay? Because we could see that the dimension of patriarchy is getting correlated with this. Then the next aspect is you could talk about temples, you could talk about pollution, you could talk about menstruation. And why such a thing is there? Most of the religions follow religious textbooks, and religious textbooks have been authored by men. Women had very poor literacy, so there is no exposure to writing or there's no exposure to reading. So things have been traditionally followed without any question. So most of the religions, the books are written by the men. We hardly know about any woman priest in any temple or mosque or church. So one or two maulavis, one or two priests, they might come up. So we hear about a large number of god women. We don't see women priests in any temple. That's not a larger case. So there again, there is an influence of religion in a job taken by a person. So today we have come up that any caste person who is having that skill can become a priest. Next, it should perhaps go on to dimensions of gender equality. That would be the future of this particular concept. Then the aspect of sexuality and the aspect of chastity or virginity associated with women and religion sanctifying it, religion giving an approval for most of it. Then religion, children, abortions, family planning. There would be a very big chain of events. All right. So with these basic points, you could write. I mean, current affairs, I think you should be talking. One was, you should talk about the NUNTOO movement, NUNTOO movement. Like Me Too, there is a NUNTOO, wherein the nuns have started coming out. Please take in points from all religions and write. So, in concluding these kind of questions, you could say, though there is an inherent patriarchy, one can see that the counter to this patriarchy is happening with the legal dimension, or with increasing literacy, or with increasing exposure, and you tell that there is more of movement towards equality, or there is more of a movement towards neutrality, like that you could say. Okay. The last question in society. The trends and patterns of urbanization in India are more exclusionary than inclusionary. Argue your stand in the same with suitable illustration. So there is a need to cite examples for every point that you're going to suggest. There are two parts to this question. One is, there is a part called trend and pattern, and second part is, there is a stand. So I can take a stand saying that it is inclusionary today. I can take a stand like that, or I can take a stand with the flow of the question itself. Fine. So let's start with an explanation of the first part. Trend and pattern of urbanization. So what are the trends? One, we could see a trend of over-urbanization. Two, we could see a trend of suburbanization. Three, we could see a trend of rapid urbanization. Fine. Four, we could see a trend of top-heavy urbanization. And five, we could see a trend of bottom-heavy urbanization. Okay. Six, we could see a trend of sprawling. Right? So for each of these things, over-urbanization trend, sub-urbanization trend, rapid urbanization trend, for each of these things you should give illustration. So over urbanization trend and suburbanization trend, for this you could cite any city. So you take various cities, one North India, one Central India, one South India, one East India, one West India. Like this, you take one example for each of the point that you're going to write. Then you can give the illustration. Okay. Now in this, top heavy urbanization means the rise of population in metropolitan and megalopolitan areas of India. So better you go with the examples of Mumbai or Kolkata, like that you could go. With bottom heavy urbanization, that means more and more towns are getting added. So every census, more towns are getting added. So number of towns are more, and population of cities are more than the population of the towns. So one is in terms of number, second is in terms of population. Number of towns are more than the number of cities that we have in India, but the population of the cities and the populations of the metro cities, they are greater than altogether put the population of all the towns of India. So population wise, cities are more, number wise, towns are more. So we are having some six trends. Sprawling means the population increase. Okay. Now when I'm writing this, you need to take the data from the census and you could put in, or you could go with illustrations. Now what are all the things that, these are the trends. Now for exclusion and inclusion part, how are you going to tell? So if I'm going to tell that there is an exclusion, what? Why is there an exclusion? We could see that certain governmental initiatives are there, wherein new districts are being created, new states are being created. And so new towns will automatically get created. In other parts, there might not be such a case. Then renaming or considering certain new towns or new cities under the Hriday scheme or under the Smart Cities Initiative. So certain new cities can get functional. So in that way, some cities will go ahead when compared to the other cities. Third is, exclusion can happen when there is a difference in policy at the central level and the state level. So the state and central politics involved. Then there could be an exclusion based on the population of the urban areas. So when the population sizes is automatically bigger, we could see that some people are invariably getting pushed into slums. So there is going to be poverty coming, and so people can get excluded there. Then we could see that certain initiatives would be taken to start educational hubs. And those educational hubs would become the new towns or the new cities. So the other parts would automatically get left behind because they are having this attraction to bring the people to study in those places. Then we could see new industrial initiatives taken with credit facilities available or with, say, some contracts or agreements being signed. With these things also, we could see that some new economic growth happening and industrialization happening and urbanization happening, and other parts which don't have that industries, they might get left out. Okay, then resource availability, and that could lead to a pattern of urbanization. It could be human resources, it could be even other resources leading to industrialization, leading to urbanization. Other parts, they don't have that, and so they are getting excluded. So based on economics, based on geography, based on polity, based on culture of poverty, based on population, we can take in some points and we could see. And we could also see a trend of religious trend. So religious towns and religious cities, when they get a prominence with the change in governments, there could be some pattern of urbanization coming because of that. So once some town becomes popular or some place of worship becomes very popular, there could be some settlements happening around it, and that itself can have some economy. When that is not there in another place, that place can get excluded. Okay, so initiatives are being taken to include. However, the trend of exclusion is more than inclusion, and you kind of call this as an urban-urban divide. Or you can even call it by another name like a town-city divide or urban-urban divide. So already there is a rural-urban divide and we are trying to bridge it. And such patterns of exclusion are leading to more of a divide between one urban area and another urban area. A city and town is not the same. One city and another city is not the same. One metro and one city is not the same. For example, now you could start giving each thing one example. Metro of Kochi compared with metro of Chennai, compared with metro of Hyderabad, compared with metro of Delhi. Delhi, more number of metro users, we could see. Then you could see that least number of metro users as it comes to. So irrespective of the time in which we have launched, we could see that multiplicity of modes of transport, right? And the cost factor, all these things are varying, right? So we could see that though the trend of urbanization is there, there could be certain other kinds of exclusion happening in, say, infrastructural growth. So that could be one thing. Then you could talk about heritage cities like Jaipur recently getting the, you could cite an example from Jaipur as well. So for illustrations, you take one Delhi example, talk about Noida, Ghaziabad and all that. You take one Calcutta example, talk about the neighboring places. You talk about one Chennai example or a Bangalore example. You talk about one example from the western part of India. Like this, you take up examples and then you can write. You have any questions? Angaka.
Billy Vandanagar is connected, right? So, okay. So, I believe compared to history and society, geography was sympathetic to you, hopefully. Okay, so the question we need to start with is, Question number five, I guess. Explain the acidification of the atmosphere and the hydrosphere. Yeah. So I think of all the 10 questions, for this question, it was surely technical. Like without it, you would not be able to answer it. See, kindly note, it is an explained question. Explain question. Now, since they've talked about explanation, we'll only need to explain it. Like few words on impacts, few words on consequences, you can add. There are no restrictions. But primary part is, if you explain it, you get maximum marks. Again, you're talking about two parameters. Acidification of atmosphere. So you're primarily talking about a consequence, acid rain. And we talk about acidification of hydrosphere again. Ocean acidification, which is a major part. So we'll talk about the structure of the answer here. So these two sections, how to address it. So as the introduction, you are asked to explain what exactly do you mean by acidification. Now, since the term acidification is involved, you are expected to say what exactly is pH. So you're locating about what the number of hydrogen ions in a specific particular area. So depending upon more number of hydrogen ions being there, it is classified as a more acidic environment. Now, since you're talking about acidification of atmosphere and hydrosphere, both will have different domains, different parameters. If you take acid rain, you can start with atmosphere or hydrosphere. You can't go for a unified explanation. Introduction simply say that pH value is less than 7, it is neutral. Then let's take atmospheric section. So under atmospheric section, you can try to understand what exactly it is. So common to both of them is your carbon dioxide or greenhouse gas emissions. Specific to acid rain is, apart from carbon dioxide, talk about sulfur dioxide emissions. The large number of sulfur dioxide industrial emissions is going to contribute to aerosol formation in clouds. So when these compounds react with presence of water, the pH value is going to be low. So if you take acid rain, the general pH value is 4.0. So any value which is any water which is actually having 4.0 is considered to be acid rain. And talking about locality where acid rain is actually happening, you're primarily focused on industrial centers. So very specific to industrial areas, you can quote northeastern part of the United States or western part of Europe, or you can take parts of China, the entire eastern coast of China, and say that it is a localized phenomenon. So this areas, if you're able to hit that itself, will be enough. If you'd want to talk about consequences, like to elaborate the area, talk about consequences on plants, animals, and human infrastructure. You can talk about corrosion of cement, corrosion of the automobiles. What will happen to human beings if human beings are actually getting impacted by acid rain? Skin lesions. You can talk about plants and animals, as such is not possible in urban areas. Plants you can definitely mention, because already urban areas have very, very low green cover. And if acid rain is going to be there in large numbers, it is going to corrode their leaves and affect the entire ecology of urban systems. Now, talking about ocean acidification, if you simply contrast with the atmosphere, it will definitely be simpler. Acid rain or the acidification of atmosphere is pretty localized, or impacts at least you can see only localized. But ocean acidification, you're talking about entire carbon dioxide emissions majorly compared to other gases. Second, ocean acidification, you're talking about the global ocean surface. You're not talking about a localized area where acidic areas is more. There might be lakes, but you're not talking about lakes alone. You're talking about oceans in general. So when you talk about hydrosphere, mention that oceans generally have an acidic pH value or basic pH value, generally. No, it is above 7. Why it is above 7? Because large amount of salinity content. So since more salinity content, the global average of pH is 8.25. Now, since this is a technical question, I need to mention values. Okay. So 8.25, if you look at globally, last 250 years, it has come down by 0.10. So 0.15, that's the global change when you talk about hydrosphere, the global change. Now, talking about the explanation for it, you can mention carbon dioxide getting dissolved in ocean waters. And since carbon dioxide is getting dissolved in ocean waters, there is going to be large amount of carbonic acid. Chemical formulas need not write at all. I'm just writing it on board. So if there is going to be more formation of carbonic acids, this word acid is important. What is going to happen to your pH? pH is going to decline. That's why it's moving from 8.25 to 8.15. So if there is going to be more acidic environment, your marine organisms are going to be affected, especially the organisms which secrete calcareous cells. Because all these calcareous cells will be dissolved in a low pH environment and your calcite compensation depth begins to increase. So those terms you were able to mention, well and good. The point is, since it is hydrosphere, if you want to mention specific lakes and rivers, you can take Yamuna for example, or you can take a place like, you can take Rhine itself. The specific places you'd like to mention, you are welcome to mention. The point is, if you address atmosphere, especially acid rain, and say that that's a local phenomenon, this is a global phenomenon, and global ocean acidification if you address, then it's more than enough. Okay? So it's a proper explanation question where more diversification is not possible. So it's pretty much restricted. Now we'll go to eighth question. What are heat waves? And then explain the consequences. Yeah. Yes. Impact of temperature meaning? High temperature. Okay. Okay, you're talking about thermal encirculation. You've always mentioned that. Okay, if you want to go till that level, you're fine. Optional? Then it's fine. Geo-optional students will definitely remember thermal circulation ocean deposits. Now the points made is for others, like can we talk about thermal island circulation? Can we talk about ocean deposits being completely damaged because of ocean defenication? You're welcome to mention. There should be no inhibition in writing optional points in GS. No problem at all. You only get going to get plus marks. Others, no problem. Political science optional, you score better in GS2. Economics optional, score better in GS3. It varies between options. You're welcome to do that. No problem. You're focusing on GS right now. What are heat waves? Explain consequences. So this was a news recently. You know, France experienced a heat wave. That's where this particular thing was put. See, kindly note. First, you're talking about what are heat waves question. Start with the definition of heat waves and explain the areas where heat waves are mostly applicable. If you've taken these two parts, then your introduction is fine. So talking about heat waves, there is no proper definition of heat waves. What are expected to write or understand is, generally, if in an area, in any area, if the surface temperature is greater than 5 degrees Celsius above average, fine, and that condition is going to persist for at least 1 week or more than few weeks, it is called as a heat wave. Any area in which the average temperature is more than 5 degrees Celsius and that is going to persist for a week or more than 5 weeks or more or few weeks. Any area, average temperature greater than 5 degrees Celsius, it's going to persist for a week or more than that, it is called as a heat wave. Fine. Now talking about the areas which are prone to heat waves, this should be simpler. Areas prone to heat waves, don't make it very complicated. Coastal area, continental area, which will experience more heat waves? Continental area. So you can draw parts of the world and mention areas which are continental, especially Russia. Fine. You can take places in interior parts of Canada also. Because they're rarely, you know, those regions which are mostly accustomed to snow, due to global climate change, they are more susceptible to heat waves. So continental compared to coastal area. So within India, you can quote examples here. Which one? Telangana. How many years back? 2 years back. Or last to last year. 3 years back only. You can also quote Telangana for continentality. Coming to the next part, in terms of latitude, tropical areas are more prone or temperate areas more prone? Think carefully. It is a temperate regions. Reason is, tropical regions always experience high temperature. So if there is already high temperature, increasing above, you know, extremely high temperature is very less. That's why temperate regions are more prone. That's why we talked about France. Even though France, most parts of France is a coastal region. So these two points you can mention, like where exactly heat waves is prone. No technicality here. Very simple. Continental versus coastal. Second point, temperate is more compared to tropical. Temperate is more compared to tropical. Okay. Now coming to consequences. So talking about consequences, you are given a freeway because it does not say explain the consequence of heat waves on humans. It simply says heat waves. So first part, we'll talk about regions as such. You can take grassland regions or agricultural regions. Drought is a major classification. Major consequence. Large area, droughts. You take France, again talking about the entire region. Ice melting or glacier melting. These are general points. So because of glacial melting, what is going to happen? Yeah, again, greenhouse gases will be emitted. All the methane which is trapped here is going to be emitted, and that is going to create large amount of problems. Now, we'll come to plants and animals in general. So within an urban environment and rural environment, which is going to experience more heat wave chances? Urban environment. Why? Because it's a heat island effect. Due to heat island effect, urban areas. So when it comes to urban areas, fauna in urban areas will be affected. You can mention birds because it's very, very difficult to find water sources in an urban area. So especially flora and fauna in urban areas are affected more due to heat island effects. Flora and fauna specific to urban area, urban ecology. Now, coming to individuals, you can talk about heat strokes. heat strokes. We can talk about loss of human productivity. Loss of human productivity. Okay. And you can also talk about grassland ecosystem, because in grassland ecosystem, if there is going to be considerable increase in temperature, forest fires. Very simple point. So ecosystem, 3 points. One is droughts. Second is ice or glacial melting. Then forest fires. When it comes to plants and animals, 1 point. Urban ecology. Human beings, you can talk about heat strokes, decline in productivity. So comprehensive, you want to add points more than this, this will be enough. Just talking about diversity. Where all you can think. Okay. Next one. What are the areas of India which are more prone hazards to low pressure systems? You're talking about a cyclone hazard map. That's the entire thing. And provide reasons for the same. So two parts of the question. First part, you're asked to explain which particular regions. That if you're able to get it, you should be comfortable. What are the regions in India? Definitely coastal regions. Coastal regions have a high amount of hazard to cyclones. Second is parts of Saurashtra and your Kathiawa Peninsula. Okay. Next part is your northeastern India, and surprisingly parts of Gangetic Plain and eastern part of Jammu and Kashmir. So these are the areas which are more prone to cyclones. Now give me reasons for these. First reason, cyclone, tropical cyclones primarily occur over water bodies, and since they are primarily occurring over water bodies, since they require large amount of moisture heat and latent heat, coastal areas are more prone to cyclones and hazards compared to areas which are interior. That can be a very, very simple point. Now, talking about region in northeastern region and your Gangetic Plains, you can talk about terrain. The reason why, in spite of the fact that quite far away from the coastal area, even though they experience more risk, is because of terrain. Reason, northeastern India is more mountainous. So if there is going to be a low pressure system, it can trigger large amount of landslides and make the impact very, very higher. You take your Gangetic Plains has large amount of meandering rivers. And one of the important irrigation what is formed in Gangetic Plains, what irrigation here? Gangetic Plains? Canal irrigation. Okay. So low pressure systems can increase the risk in these regions because of terrain and topography. Fine. Tell me about Ladakh and parts of Rajasthan. Why Ladakh and Rajasthan would come here in the cyclone? High risk zone, Ladakh is here. And parts of Rajasthan also. What could be the reason? Western disturbance. Now you're getting it. See, kindly note, if you take western disturbance, that's why it is mentioned low pressure systems, not just tropical cyclones. Because of western disturbances, parts of Rajasthan and Ladakh are prone to cyclones. That's one area where you could miss. So if you're only thinking about tropical cyclones, you could miss a point. Always mention low pressure systems. So quick question, western disturbances are going to be high rainfall or low rainfall systems compared to tropical cyclone? Low rainfall. In spite of that, why Ladakh and Rajasthan high risk? In spite of that. Think about Ladakh and Rajasthan, you'll get idea. Are they dry regions or wet regions? Dry regions. Now you should tell me the answer. See, thing is, dry regions do not have proper wetland ecosystems. That is, if there is going to be more availability of water, they do not have proper channels how they can distribute water. Wetland ecosystems always have some channel. Dryland do not know how to handle water. If you look at soil percolation capacity or areas in which water is going to be redirected, it is not much at all. That is the primary reason why dryland regions are more prone to flash floods if there is going to be increase in rainfall. Okay. It's okay. If you want to give a very bad example, I'll give you one. It's more like a chain smoker versus a person who's smoking for the first time. A chain smoker would be very comfortable with a cigarette, but the person who smokes for the first time is going to be very, very difficult. Again, smoking causes cancer, it's injurious to health. Okay, just to give you an example between dryland and wetland ecosystems. Moving to the next part, what are the areas of, okay, that we've seen, 9. Question number 10. Question number 10, examine why waterways in India are unable to emulate their European counterparts. So India versus Europe when it comes to waterways. You can write your standard reasons. The only thing expected is when you quote it, simply quote examples from Europe. Like this is very successful in India, this is very not. Start from climate of India. So start from physical geography, then go to human geography. So start with this. When you take India, rainfall is concentrated only on 3 months of the year. So only 3 to 4 months of the year, and only then you receive large amount of rainfall, which means your waterway cannot be used for trade and transport throughout the year. Basic problem, climate. Simple reasons. First is this temporal distribution of rainfall, which means your waterways cannot operate throughout the year. Then talk about spatial distribution. Spatial distribution, you can talk about two parameters within it. That is, you can talk about the divide between north and south. You take, you know, waterways in North India, they receive more rain. Waterways in South India is going to receive less rain, rivers. So that is going to affect the functioning of waterways throughout. Second part, within a river basin, there is variation. You can take the example of Ganga River Basin. Ganga River Basin, lower Gangetic Plain is going to receive large amount of water. That is not going to be there in the upper Gangetic Plain. So if there is going to be variation in water level, it is difficult to operate waterways. So 3 points within this. First is temporal factor, reception of rainfall. Second is spatial factor, reception of rainfall. Between north and south, northern rivers, southern rivers. Within northern rivers, there is going to be variation within the same river basin. The kindly notes, we are talking about climate. So in all of your statements, what is expected is you make this link with the river system to waterway. Now, since rainfall is not there, or since water is not available all the time, it is not able to waterways in India. But you take European region, western part of Europe, what climate are we experiencing? Yeah, Mediterranean climate in southern way. You find British climate, northern parts of France. So British climate, most important characteristic of climograph is you find rainfall throughout the year. Okay, so since there is consistent rainfall throughout the year, you'll be able to operate your waterways without any problem. Same parameter. Okay, now let's come to complexity in terrain. So when you talk about terrain, India's terrain is more and more complex when you take about European region. Because you can quote this particular link itself, Kinnan-Betwa. Even though Kinnan-Betwa is a very important river interlinking project envisaged in India for water linking, Kinnan-Betwa does not have the same sloping pattern throughout the journey. Meaning, when the river is actually interlinked, there are areas in which water is naturally flowing from a higher level to lower level. That there are sections in which water will need to be pumped up to go from areas of surplus to areas of deficit. That is a problem in India. That is not the case with most rivers in Europe. You got the difference, I guess, which means your waterway cannot be operated. So during interlinking of rivers, there is complexity in slope. During interlinking of rivers, complexity in slope. That's not the case with Europe. And most important points comes from this. Solid waste management. One of the major reasons why Indian waterways are not successful is large number of sewage is getting dumped into our waterways. Example, Yamuna. Mention Yamuna River. Contrast Yamuna River with Thames River. Thames in London. In contrast those things. So even though Thames used to have those problems, now it is completely rectified. But Yamuna, still the problem is there. Since this is a GS1 paper, bring in history parameter also. See, historically, Europeans' waterways have always been maintained. Example, Rhine waterway. Rhine has remained a very important waterway throughout European history. That if you look at countries like these, Belgium, especially Netherlands, and Luxembourg, entire infrastructure of all the cities, which you find there, all the minor towns, will be structured based on waterways. So large number of goods will be coming through these waterways. And if you look at the house construction, everything is modified based on that. So historically, there is more importance to conservation of waterways in Europe, but that is not found in India. Okay, because India was under different administrations and different kingdoms historically, and hence you do not find this problem. Okay. And talking about last point, you can mention this factor. Even though it is not geographic, you can always add this. Because 4 points you write geography, history, 1 point you add finance, the person is not going to care. You can insert it, you can talk about finance. Right now, they were able to convert Thames from the Great Sting to a proper waterway only because of investment. And India is already a developing nation which has other needs. So right now, it cannot pool so much money into waterways. We can finish with that. So 10 marks, I think this should be more than enough along with diagrams. More should be more than enough. Okay. Yeah, what are the states that you can mention? Quality should be comfortable. Again, you can mention, no issues. After writing GS1 points, add those. No problem at all. You can talk about coordination between states. That also can be mentioned. So question 14, very important current affairs, right? Creation of union territory in India is an expression of India's geography. Problem was, it says India's geography, so can't mention history and society points. Justify question. So it is right. Let's start with the simpler ones. You can take Daman and Diu. And then Dadra Nagar Haveli. So these two things, it is simply surface area. The surface area of these two union territories is extremely less. Hence, they do not have enough economic clout for financing themselves. Surface area is very less. Cumulatively, they form approximately only 500 square kilometers. If you want the actual data. You take both of them together, only 500 square kilometers. That is the reason. So then a comfortable one, which you can always mention. See, this particular answer is asked in 15 marks. The only way the answer will work is only if you use this in your paper. After mentioning what exactly is Union Territory in India, have a tabulation. For Daman and Diu, put your India map. Locate that these two very important locations. Then you put your Indian Arabian Peninsula and say that Lakshadweep is located here, Andaman is located here. So these two are strategic locations. Put one more map. Say that if you take Pondicherry, Pondicherry is located here, it is located in Andhra Pradesh, it is located in Kerala. So multiple territories hence need to be Union Territory. That's the only way you can expand this answer. Fine. Use the same thing for Ladakh also. Ladakh is a cold desert. Fine. So the only way you can expand this answer is using maps. And because reasons are very less. So Lakshadweep Andaman and Nicobar Islands, same story. It is located in Indian Ocean region. Andaman and Nicobar Islands is very much close to Malacca Strait, which is a very, very important strategic place. It should not be given to state government for control. You take Lakshadweep, apart from being a very important strategic location, India should focus more on environmental conservation, and Lakshadweep has large amount of atolls. You can write it, no harm in that. India government is focused on conservation. Talking about Pondicherry, just make sure you give different colors. Just say that Puducherry is here, Mahe is here, and Karaikal is somewhere, Yanam is somewhere. Since it is dispersed, it was under the control of French, it was dispersed in three different locations. So three different locations would not be advisable to give a state government and monitor. Yeah. That's the only issue. That's why I'm speaking only about geography. LLC will have more points. You're right. Yeah. Justify. It's a common question. You should be very comfortable. That's what makes this question very difficult. L should be cakewalk. It's Lakshmikant paper. I think fourth chapter, fifth chapter, he himself would have given reasons. Now we're inventing reasons. That's why. So French, you can say that it was under French control, location of three different territories, and hence this cannot be under one single government. Hence it is brought under Union Territories. Then for Chandigarh, what artificial reason you can write? There is one. Language. Yeah, sure. Okay. Yeah. After mentioning these things, you can mention, historically we have references in which Northwest Frontier Province was there. You can mention Northeastern Frontier Province. You can do that, but make sure that it comes later, yeah, after these things. So even under Indian history, we have fruit provinces. If you are running out of points, you can always mention. Chandigarh, you can mention the issue of language. Because Punjab, Lahore was used to be the capital of Punjab, and after it was taken out, there has to be a situation where a balance need to be maintained linguistically between Punjab and Haryana. And hence, Chandigarh was thrown to be the important state. And to balance it, for linguistic reasons, it was given as a union territory for both the places. Fine? And since it's a very planned city, then finally, there is no reason for Delhi. There is nothing in Delhi. So Delhi, I'd recommend not to use it because you cannot justify it based on geography. There is only historical reason. Now let's come to, again, when you finish the answer, kindly note, when does your Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh become union territories? 31st of October. So 31st of October meaning before you write your mains. Fine. So Ladakh and Jammu and Kashmir, if you are mentioning, mention at the last. At the same time, there are few proposed union territories. So Ladakh is a cold desert which is deprived of environment, economic development. Hence, you can say that. Again, Jammu and Kashmir, we can't touch on base of geography. If they made it Jammu as a plateau region, Kashmir as a valley, we can say cold desert, plateau plain. It would have been easy to write in terms of geography, but we can't do it. Ladakh, we can say it's a cold desert. Fine. So now moving to the next part. So diagrams will help you out to extend this answer. That's the point I'm trying to drive. Okay. Next question is, renewable energy is a potential replacement for fossil fuels for energy needs of India. Now I'll just tell you where you might have gone wrong. This one. That's the only catch in the question. How many of you wrote only about electricity? Not done, right? You've written only about electricity, then you usually mistake come. Only about electricity, you're missing it. It simply says energy needs. You talk about transportation, fuel and everything and so on and so forth. So introduction, you can start with, it's an assess question. You need to say whether the statement is particularly true or wrong. Since it's an assess question, you start with India's energy mix and so on and so forth. Look at India's energy mix, more than 45%. I'd rather write it. 45% it is coal. 22 or 23% comes from biomass. And approximately, again, 20-odd% comes from natural gas and oil. So we look at predominantly, it is fossil fuel composition, then biomass takes it up. So only after this, you have a hydro energy coming in, renewable energy coming in. So percentage of renewable energy is very, very less. So you can say this at the start of the introduction itself. Thing is, even if you're not given these percentages, just say that fossil fuels, coal and natural gas dominate 70% of India's energy needs. No one's going to worry about it. At the end of the day, that should be maximum. That's it. Now we'll go for assessments. See, kindly note, we can split it into major sections. First is transportation energy needs. So when it comes to transportation energy needs, India doesn't have a replacement. So when you assess this, say that oil and natural gas is primarily used as a mode of transport. And if you look at natural resources, do we have enough natural resources in India? We don't have. So except for a few places like Bombay High or you take northeastern India, the amount of natural resource of oil and natural gas is not much. So if you look at replacements also, only replacement is biomass. So even if you take biomass, biomass is only at the preliminary stage. We do not have segregation in urban areas as, you know, degradable waste and non-degradable waste. Only when you have this classification, you will be able to process it into biomass. So since this differentiation is not there, segregation is not there, it is very, very difficult for doing it. So that should be an honest explanation. So you can say that when you conclude for this particular section, if India is able to pursue aggressive policy for segregation of waste, then maybe biomass can be an important replacement. Like India can rely on that. Okay. Now we'll come to the largest part, electricity generation. So under electricity generation, let's say what are the positives you can write with reference to India's geography. So that's, again, use a stream of diagrams. So first you say that India is a tropical country, Tropic of Cancer passes through. So large amount of sunlight, solar. Next part, you say that India has an extremely large amount of coastline. There is a more possibility of wave energy. Then you say that India has large amount of undulations and bays here and there. So 1, 2, 3, 4 multiple locations are there. Here, tidal energy. Simply use the map. Then after that, you say that India has monsoon and climate. Because of monsoon and climate, you have southwest monsoon, northeastern monsoon, wind energy. Offshore winds you can use. Offshore winds, onshore winds. So you can use geography part and say more and more. Now let's come for practical analysis, like assessment. You can say this part, I mean, writing this is no issue. So when you do the assessment, biggest problem with solar energy is India's access to semiconductors. Like we do not produce semiconductors or manufacture them in large numbers. Hence, we rely on others. Second thing, solar energy is again focused more on only few months of the year. So few months, it's very, very hot. Few months, it's very cold. So solar power or solar energy is susceptible to intermittency. It cannot be produced throughout the year. Second, solar energy is intraday. Within a day, during daytime, you'll be able to produce more. But during nighttime means you'll not be able to take much for solar energy. So inconsistencies of solar energy, write it with specific to India, that's all. So generally, these are general criticisms of solar energy, what I'm saying. But you can say it as specific to India. So when it comes to wave energy, simply say technology or investment is not there. Yeah, storage capacity, and that's the point I'm trying to make. Like you, whatever you generate in day or summer cannot be stored and used it in winter or night time. That's the major thing when it comes to solar, not just India. So general criticism, each and everything, general criticism, if you're able to write, do it. So wave energy, you can say that technology is not available. Wind speeds are not consistent throughout the year because that's what is going to generate waves. General criticism against tidal energy, it is going to damage your ecosystems. Again, it is not going to be consistent area of power. In different bays of India, you're going to have different powers of geoelectricity. So Saurashtra will be different. You go to West Bengal, again, it is going to be different. General criticism against wind energy again. Yeah, cost of installation, again, it is seasonal. Problem of storage. So if you're going to have multiple different types of energy in grid connection, that is going to create even more problems. So only thing is, write about different parts of energy with reference to India as how it can be generated. That is part. General reasons why it can be relied on. That is why it cannot be a replacement of fossil fuels. Write the general criticism of all them and link it. The answer will be over. I think of the link how to structure it. Because everything is going to be general criticism, write it specific to India. India's population is very, very high. Hence, we cannot do that. India aspires to be a 5 trillion economy. Hence, these type of power generation is not going to be consistent in helping it. So those words, if you are going to insert it, it will look like specifically for India. Criticism will be general, general points. Got the difference? I think this should have been a comfortable question. I think 16.2, explain jet streams. What are the climatic changes they bring about? This should be a very comfortable question, I guess. Because first 7.5 is a proper jet stream question. Start with what exactly a geostrophic wind, which is balance between your no frictional force, balance between Coriolis force and your pressure gradient force. Then say that these are fast flowing, long, narrow, meandering winds, so on and so forth. Then do locate the location of jet stream, subtropical high pressure belt, subpolar low pressure belt, both the hemispheres. We are studying more on polar jet stream because this jet stream is very, very powerful. So talking about these, then coming to impacts. Impacts on climate, or you know what they can do to climate change, three major things. First is this, I think you're very, very familiar with this. Because of meandering motion, they'll be able to create alternate areas of high pressure and alternate areas of low pressure. So this is a general traditional diagram. So because of this, they can either contribute to rainfall or they can hinder rainfall. You can example, you can either mention England, because England's climate is primarily determined by these jet streams, or recently, between last 2 to 3 years, Pakistan was in use. Because one of the low pressure systems which was created during winter season, that pressure system got broke away and then migrated towards Pakistan. So Pakistan had a period of unexpected high rainfall, okay, during its drought season. Shall I flip over? So next plot we'll usually write, recent polar vortex news. Due to meandering of jet streams, it's a possibility that if it is going to shift southward, cold polar winds from the interior region can come and affect the areas which is here. So basic example is your polar vortex. And third part, jet streams are able to influence world climate better because of they have the ability to shift along with pressure belt. They move northward during summer season and move southward during winter season. So best example is your pressure belt affecting your India itself. So western disturbances you can mention. So these things are the major things when it comes to jet streams. Again, one more point, not required. Just understand that when it comes to winter season, if it is winter is going to be very, very severe, your two jet streams can combine together at times, at few locations. Your polar jet stream and your subtropical jet stream, at times over few locations, they can combine. That's a recent development, okay, or observation. Coming to the last part, I think. Yeah. You can always write about it, no problem. So the question was the climatic changes they bring about. The point is, don't restrict yourself to India, that's all. Now what people think is jet streams will immediately start writing monsoon. You can speak about any jet stream. Global, you can talk about global jet stream, local jet stream classification. You're familiar with that. Then you can talk about Somalian region. You have West African jet streams. There is a jet stream in Southern Africa also. So all those, if you're familiar with, you can write it. No issues. That's the explained part. Thing is, when it comes to effect on climate, similar to India, same thing will be writing again and again. Somali jet stream and your South African or West African jet stream. Got it? You can always mention India. No issues. Thing is, it'll be the opposite. Usually people restrict themselves to India. 17. Plate tectonics played a major role in biodiversity distribution across the world. Analyze. Comfortable or not? Not comfortable. Geo-optional. Talk to you then. Huh? So please give a simple introduction of what exactly is plate tectonics. Draw over. The entire world is made of plates. Based on interaction of plates, volcanic eruptions, mountains, everything is formed. Just mention the major plates. Then using those plates, start explaining. First thing, plates have always undergone movements. So since they've undergone movements, based on their location, the climate of that area is actually determined. So that's the first important factor. This you've written comfortably. Seconds. Now take areas of plate movement. For example, you take North America colliding with Pacific plates. We say that here mountain ranges are formed. So only in areas of convergent boundaries are going to have high mountains. And in areas of high mountains, with increase in altitude, there is going to be decrease in temperature because of the biodiversity is varying at multiple levels. Fine. Let's take third point. You say that because of variation plate tectonics, there are areas in which you can have volcanic eruptions. You take South America. So South America, there are large amount of volcanoes which are present due to convergent plate boundary. Due to volcanic eruptions, your soil is very, very rich. But in countries like Australia, which is not located in plate boundary, the soils are very, very poor. Hence, biodiversity is less. Not because volcanic ash is going to contribute. Now, flipping over, you can mention this particular point. Plate tectonics play a major role in differentiation of animals. You can talk about marsupial distribution. Like marsupials are primarily oriented towards Australia. You can talk about this. You can talk about how animals were distributed between North America and South America. Isthmus of Panama. So only after Isthmus of Panama, landmass was formed between North and South America, animals started migrating between North and South. You can talk about this particular factor also, fifth one. How plate tectonics in terms of ocean deposits, because you have trenches, and trenches will have different biodiversity when compared to areas which are shallow water. So shallow water versus deep water, that is actually determined by plate tectonics, so convergent plate boundary. You can talk about mid-Atlantic ridge. Say that mid-Atlantic ridge has large number of volcanoes, underwater volcanoes, and geothermal vents and underwater volcanoes have different types of ecosystem compared to other areas. Because in Middle Atlantic, you all have different volcanic eruptions. That is going to influence it. So you see that you have points. Each and everything, if it is linked to the diagram, you should be comfortable. Since it is an analyzed question, you need not justify it also. You can say that other factors, in spite of plate tectonics, climate is a factor. Due to human migration, due to human activities, things are getting moved from one place to another. You can mention all factors also. The point is, when you write these things, mention plates and rate. That is the only thing. How plates are actually influencing these things. If you've done this, you should be comfortable. So I believe compared to history and society, geography was always and is always comfortable. Okay. So I think we'll close. Any doubts? Yeah? Okay. Thank you. Take care.